Hey, how's it going? You're listening to the Change Truth podcast, and today my guest is Martin Ball. Martin has a PhD in religious studies, and he's a professor at the University of Southern Oregon. He's also an author, a musician, an artist, and the host of his own podcast. He also has one idea in particular that he's become quite known for, and it's called non-duality. And I'm going to let him really explain it because he does a great job. But to give you an idea, it's the idea that you and I are not as separate from each other or the world around us as we perceive to be. So we talk a lot about that in sort of the later half of the podcast. But before that, to start out, I asked Martin how he feels some of these psychedelic drugs can actually come into our culture now and help people on more practical terms. So, yeah, check it out. This is me with Martin Ball.
There's a lot of, I would say, therapeutic uses for psychedelics, but there's also a lot of other uses as well. And one of the things that I think is very important when discussing psychedelics is not to put them all into the category of a therapeutic context and the idea that you should only be taking it if there's something wrong with you that you're trying to fix. So, for example, this is something that we see in the marijuana legalization movement, where kind of the first dominoes to fall were on the medical use of marijuana.
Right. Yeah.
And so we see, you know, starting in California, that state after state is starting to enact legislation saying that, well, people should have access to marijuana as medicine. But there's a lot of other reasons that people might want to be using marijuana, not because they feel that they need it as a medicine, because they're deriving other benefits from marijuana. So I think that we see a very similar kind of thing taking place in the psychedelic movement, is that there's kind of this push with a lot of scientific studies and things being done on the therapeutic side, which I think is great, but it's also important that we honor and recognize the fact that there's a lot of other reasons that people like them, because it opens up their creativity. Or, you know, I'll just be really clear about it. Taking some mushrooms and wandering around Burning Man is one of the greatest things you could ever experience. And that right. has nothing to do with therapeutics. It has to do with the fact that it's an aesthetic experience that's beautiful and captivating. And human beings are aesthetic beings, that we are drawn to experiences that are aesthetically pleasing and novel. So it's understandable that people want to use psychedelics for these more recreational purposes. And I think that that's perfectly legitimate. But I think that it's also quite interesting that there are all of these therapeutic uses. Right. Recently, I published a short essay in Spirituality and Health magazine, and also did a very brief interview for their podcast for that magazine. And in that, what I did is I outlined what I see as three primary models for the therapeutic use of psychedelics. And so maybe I'll just quickly review what I'm delineating as these different models. The first I'm calling the scientific medical model. And this is dealing with things like you've just mentioned, where someone has cluster headaches. Well, an effective medicine for dealing with cluster headaches has been found to be LSD and psilocybin, that people suffer these terrible, debilitating headaches. And one dose of LSD or psilocybin can relieve them of cluster headaches for as much as a year. And that's pretty astounding in terms of
substantial,
as a medical effect. We also are seeing studies with treating people with things like depression, end-of-life anxiety, you know, so this is more in the psychological realm. But here in the medical scientific model, generally what we're operating from is standard definitions, medical definitions of illnesses. So looking at it from a biophysical, psychological context. And then usually the application of the psychedelic medicine is limited in that it's maybe one dose or maybe a small number of doses over a series of therapeutic sessions to help bring someone to a more therapeutically beneficial state of mind or state of emotionality, or treating their physical condition, whatever that may be. And so this is one of the areas where culturally we're seeing a lot of activity right now, because this is something that's easy to study in a medical context or in a university context. It's something that you can get grants for.
That's a big thing to get funding for. That's kind of Why people are really pushing for that, because they can actually get funded.
Yeah, they can get funding, and there's also a sense of social legitimacy to these kinds of activities, where then you can publish in a medical journal or a scientific journal and say, look, we conducted this study, here are their controls, here's the illness etiologies that we're working with, here's the medications and the placebos that we're using, and these are the results that we got. So it's very quantifiable, it's easy to present, it's something that gets picked up by newspapers and online media outlets that say, hey, here's this new study. So we've been seeing a lot of that recently, and I think that that's a very significant place for activity at this current stage of the psychedelic movement, because again, there's a lot of legitimacy there, and it's presenting things from a more neutral scientific perspective, where it's not really asking people to believe in spirits and entities and realms and the rest of the stuff that gets associated with psychedelics. It's very straightforward. It's like you have a condition, you go to the doctor, doctor gives you a pill, you have your session, you feel better.
Yeah, it's something that people can kind of understand, and it's just a way to prove to people through the sort of scientific model that they're used to seeing, used to being presented ideas through, that they can sort of relate to in that way. But you're talking about the fact that while things like cluster headaches and things that are very, a lot of these conditions can be helped through these, you don't see that as being like the only way these things can help people. There's a vast array of things. And I think a lot of it might come down to the fact that like some physical conditions have a sort of mental side to them. And if you can help people fix that sort of whatever's going on in there, they can then help fix themselves, whether it's physically or with sort of like anxiety type of issues and stuff like that, that leads to physical problems as well, right?
Right, which is one of the great benefits of working with psychedelics, is that they're not just operating at a physical, mechanical level, they're also operating simultaneously at an emotional and at a mental level, and then some people would also say at a spiritual level. But you know, I leave that to a different part of the discussion, because then we're getting into belief systems and metaphysics and things like that. And certainly something that we're learning in modern medicine is that the mental and emotional aspect of healing are very important for overcoming any kind of issue, whether it's physical or mental or emotional. That it's one thing to have cancer, for example, but our attitude and beliefs and feelings around the cancer can certainly compound the issue and make it much more difficult for people. So that's why, like now with Johns Hopkins University and some other places, they've been conducting studies of not treating cancer with psychedelics. They're treating the mental and emotional baggage that comes with getting diagnosed with cancer with things like psilocybin. Right. And so that people, in a sense, are making peace with their disease. And that makes them more flexible and open to healing, rather than creating sort of a self-victimizing narrative within their mind and the emotionality surrounding that, like, oh, I'm gonna die, and it's so
it's
terrible.
A very stressful situation for people, I can imagine, right?
And so people can then reach a place where they say, well, yeah, I'm going to die, and that's okay. Because they've gone through this process of dissolving the ego and kind of going into these transpersonal states. And so they can release some of their fear around that. And then whether or not they actually do die from the cancer or not, it actually makes it more likely that they're able to be healed by whatever treatments they are then undergoing to address the cancer, because they're not overloading and overlayering on top of the cancer all of this mental projection and attachment and unresolved emotional issues. So it just makes them more susceptible to healing.
Right.
And all of this is a way of putting this information out into the general public so that they're dealing with actual facts surrounding psychedelics, rather than just the propaganda that people have been fed that these things have no medical uses. I mean, this is something that has now definitively been proven to be incorrect. You know,
it's funny, like, that despite there being so much proof, to try to make change legally is so slow. Like, it's ridiculous that it takes so long. You have to change, I think. I mean, it seems like you can attack this in two ways. You can go, okay, We just have to go after the government or the people who make the laws themselves and get them to change it. Or you go after the people and you say, we got to educate the people first. And then the spineless politicians are just going to follow whatever the people want anyway. So we just have to educate folks. But the fact that it takes so long after, like, look at marijuana. I mean, in Canada, you can't get, there's no recreational marijuana. In the States now, a few states have legalized it recreationally. But even that has taken so long. And like you said, it started with a medical model. But the fact that our system moves so slow when we can prove that things work, I think it's a reflection on how we need to change sort of the structure in place. Because if we can find something that works to help people in these ways, we need to make that available quick. Like, to, yeah, you know, we don't have 20 years to wait for people to deal with their PTSD and whatever, you know, it's kind of ridiculous how slow it is.
Yeah. Well, unfortunately, belief systems tend to be resistant to facts. And that's something that we're dealing with here at the societal level, that if someone has just become absolutely convinced that psychedelics are bad, that it doesn't really matter how many facts you present them with. They'll say, no, it's bad. It's bad. And so it does make it difficult of, like, what is the best avenue to take? And again, I think that medical marijuana and recreational marijuana is a good model that, you know, when the first time I ever experienced marijuana was when I was 14 years old. I'm 42 now. So that was a while ago. And at that time, I experienced marijuana. And my very first thought was, wow, this is great. And then my second thought was, everything I've been told about marijuana is a lie.
Yeah.
None of it's true. And at that point, as, you know, a 14-year-old kid in my high school, I became a marijuana activist. I started, you know, passing out information for about why it should be legalized and all of that. And at that time, it was just kind of a hope and dream that these things might actually change. I didn't believe that they would, because there was so much societal resistance to it. And at that time, if you took a poll nationwide asking people, do you think marijuana should be legalized either for recreational uses or for medicine, it probably would have been around like 30% or something right. Like that.
It slowly built up in that sense.
Right. But then it seems at this point that we've reached a tipping point, that I don't think we're ever going to go under 50% in terms of support for legalization at this point in the United States nationwide. And yeah, that especially among young people, support, I think, is probably more around 75%. So as the older generation that is more entrenched in their beliefs because they've bought into the propaganda about marijuana, as they move out of positions of power and younger people then ascend into those positions, I think that we're going to see a lot more changes. And right now in the United States, it's happening on a state-by-state basis. But what we're moving towards is that at some point, the federal government will have to admit that it's illegitimate to schedule marijuana as a Schedule I substance, which means it has no medicinal value and it has high likelihood towards abuse and addiction. All of these things have now been scientifically proven to be not true. Mm-hmm. And so now that the scientific evidence is out there, it becomes much harder for any politician to say, no, it's just bad. You know, they become the ostrich, just sticking their head in the sand, that they're not wanting to look at reality. And I mean, now it's kind of a joke in the United States whenever a politician says that marijuana is bad, because people have seen all the evidence.
Mm-hmm.
And
sure, yeah.
So the same thing is happening with psychedelics. And another area in which this is happening, psychedelics, is, so this is my second model. So the first model, again, is the scientific medical.
Right, yeah.
The next model is what I'm calling the religious, spiritual, shamanic use of psychedelics.
Okay,
now,
yeah,
here we're going beyond the medical model where people are talking about spiritual issues and spiritual diseases or problems that can be treated through the conscious use of psychedelics. And this is where we most often see the term of entheogen being used rather right. than psychedelic, where this is something that is generating the experience of the divine and people feel that they're being healed by this and that they're growing spiritually and mentally and emotionally. And this is another area where now we're starting to see legal challenges take place. So here in Ashland, Oregon,
right.
we have the Santo Daime Church, which uses daime, which is their word for ayahuasca, for anyone who's not familiar with that. And this church drinks ayahuasca as their ceremonial sacrament. And they do view it as a healing process that people are undergoing as they come and they perform their ceremonies, which are called works. Now, ayahuasca, of course, contains DMT, dimethyltryptamine, which is an illegal substance in most countries. Mm-hmm. And here, the local church here in Ashland took the federal government to court under the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, which allows for legal exceptions if a religious body can show that the law is infringing with their ability to practice their religion. Right. So this ultimately, the Santo Daime Church won that court case. Now, this does not legalize the use of ayahuasca in the United States. It only legalizes it for them and in the context of their church. And the court case was also set up in such a way that the ruling only applied to Santo Daime churches in Oregon. So this was kind of an odd thing. Yeah, so it made it legally recognizing their right in Oregon. Now, the difficulty is that there are Santo Daime points, that's what they call their churches or points. Hmm. They're all across the United States. They're not just here in Oregon.
Yeah, yeah. But they can't use it? The other ones?
Not legally.
Okay.
So yeah. This becomes a religious liberty issue, mm-hmm. which is, you know, kind of a hot topic in the United States right now.
Sure.
And in many respects always has been, but currently it's undergoing some social upheaval around these issues of religious liberty. Primarily,
the American church also has a similar right as well. In Canada and the States, I believe, is where they can use peyote in sort of a ceremonial, spiritual sort of way as well.
Yeah, and that is due to the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, and also more specifically, the Native American Religious Freedom Restoration Act. So what happened there was, this is also a court case that generated out of Oregon, where a member of the Native American church lost his job and his ability to receive benefits from his job because he went to church and he ate peyote.
Oh, and that's how it started.
Yeah, so that ended up as a court case that went all the way to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court, just to summarize, the Supreme Court basically said, look, fella, it's fine if you believe that peyote is a ceremonial sacrament. That's fine. You have freedom of belief in this country. However, if you actually take it and consume it, you're violating our drug laws, and therefore you are subject to arrest or whatever punishment the state deems fit to put upon you. So Congress reacted to that by saying, well, look, it's one thing to say we have freedom of religion to believe whatever we want, but if people don't actually have freedom to practice what we want, then it's not a real protection of freedom.
And what's the point? Yes.
Yeah. This is like saying, you know, you can believe whatever you want, but if you actually do anything about it, now you're breaking the law. Mm-hmm. So in creating the Native American Religious Freedom Restoration Act, it specifically allows for anyone who is a Native American who's a member of a registered and federally recognized tribe, they can legally participate in the Native American church and consume, grow, and transport peyote, and they are not subject to federal drug laws or state drug laws as well. They are exempted from that. And then the more general Religious Freedom Restoration Act allows for similar possible cases to go before the court, such as the Santo Daime case, where people can argue that, yes, we are consuming an illegal substance, but this is our religious practice, and your laws are burdening our ability to practice our religion, so an exemption should be made.
Right.
And all this came about because the Supreme Court did not recognize the freedom to practice. And also here in Oregon, the state government in Oregon has gone further than that and said that anyone can legally become a member of the Native American church, whereas in everywhere else in the United States, you can only legally participate in the church if you are a Native American. So that's actually the only racially defined religious freedom law in the United States is the Native American Religious Freedom Restoration Act. And
that's
use of
pretty
peyote.
Cool. Oregon seems like the spot to be, huh? They're making all the changes to start out, hey?
Yeah, it is somewhat of an epicenter, and that's largely due to the fact that there are just large medicine communities here in Oregon with the Santo Daime Church, Native American Church. We're kind of the Northwest Coast hippie epicenter.
Yeah,
in a sense. So our population isn't that big, but the number of people who are involved in this. I mean, if the federal government wanted to get serious about enforcing drug laws, especially here in Southern Oregon, they'd have to come in and arrest entire communities because these people have been growing marijuana for generations. They've been eating peyote for generations. They've been drinking ayahuasca for generations. And they'd literally have to come in and arrest everyone. And it would what are you going to do with a whole state worth of people?
Yeah. So that strength in numbers thing. And that's, I think, how this is going to change nationwide and worldwide as well. Is it's kind of, I kind of relate it to the gay rights movement where people had to sort of come out of the closet and sort of build that community and just start being honest about it. And then things slowly, people sort of caught on like, oh my God, my neighbor's gay. I had no idea. He's a pretty good guy. And then I think it's going to be that kind of thing where people just have to sort of come out, say that they use stuff, even if they use stuff like cocaine and they're like, yeah, you know what? I do use cocaine on the weekend, whatever. And then people are just like, oh, well, you know, he has his shit together and he uses cocaine once in a while, or just drugs in general. If people just start being honest instead of just hiding about it, you know, instead of just burying everything in their closet and not talking about it and not being honest. I think because people will be surprised how many people actually use drugs, whether they're psychedelics or whether it's marijuana or whatever, or just getting drunk on the weekend, you know, like so many people have a vice of some kind that they're using. And I think even when we're talking about harmful drugs, even when we're talking about heroin or crack cocaine or meth, even, I think if, I mean, my, it's my opinion that I think if they're legalized in some regulated way, it's going to be much safer for people and much more beneficial in the long run for people than having them illegal. And I don't know if you're like, what are your thoughts as far, like, if you could change all the laws in the world tomorrow, would you make everything completely legal, or would you have it sort of some kind of regulated form? Maybe you have to go to a church or a doctor to get a prescription for mushrooms, or, you know, how would you do it?
I would definitely just prefer full legalization. It's this weird irony, I think, especially when we're dealing with like religious rights and things like that, that here we have, for example, let's go back to ayahuasca. We have this substance that is incredibly powerful and also has lots of applications. It has a lot of things that you can use it for. And I do think it's very ironic that we protect the rights of someone that throws a bunch of beliefs and superstitions and religious structures onto that and say, oh, well, you believe a bunch of stuff about this, so you have a legal right to take it. But someone who doesn't have beliefs around it, that somehow their use of it is less protected, that to me just seems like a really, really weird irony. That it's really the state is saying, well, unless you have a lot of funny religious beliefs, we're not going to recognize your right. Whereas, you know, you're a rational, down to earth individual, and so, but you have no rights around this. So I think that full legalization, I think, would be ideal. And certainly looking at the criminal justice system, just here in the United States, I mean, I'll focus on that because that's what I'm most familiar with. Due to the quote war on drugs, we now have a larger prison population than any country has ever had in the history of the world. We lock up more of our people for drugs and drug offenses than anyone ever has anywhere. And we're talking about the worst dictatorships and totalitarian regimes. We are number one in the world in locking up our citizens. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes drug offenses, people are getting longer prison terms than people who are committing rape and murder. And this is insane. Mm-hmm. This is no way to run a society. And it's also bankrupting society. And on top of that, it also tends to be applied along racial lines, that people of color in this country are far more likely to be imprisoned for drug offenses than whites and Caucasians. even though these are minority populations. And so whites are using drugs a lot more proportionally than any other community in the United States, but they're the least likely to end up in prison. So it's really an extension of racist power structures in the United States. So if we want to correct that imbalance, the war on drugs should be ended unequivocally and immediately. And everyone who has been arrested for nonviolent drug offenses should immediately be released from prison, and they should have their records expunged.
Yeah, I agree with that. I agree. I think it should be legal on that. I mean, there's little small details we could work out. Like maybe you do an age restriction like alcohol. Maybe there's a few little things here and there. But in general, I think people should just have the freedom to choose. I mean, the major thing is they're doing it anyway. Like having it illegal is doing nothing anyway. So what the fuck is the point? Like kid, like high school kids can go get any drug they want. It's not that hard. They probably have an easier time finding connections to get drugs than adults do. So
and they, you know, young people have an easier time getting illegal drugs than they do getting alcohol. And why is that? That's because alcohol is legal and regulated. Whereas if we're leaving things into the black market, then it makes it accessible to people. But if you had to go to the shop and show ID to get marijuana, and if someone was going to lose their license or lose their business because they sold to someone who was underage, that puts it much more into the area of reasonable social control than just saying it's illegal. Because there is always going to be an underground market. And this is also something that it's really important to look at human history. That, I mean, if we're just looking at marijuana, this is probably the first cultivated crop human beings ever bothered growing. So humans have been working with this plant for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. And the idea that we can come in with a social program where we're going to arrest everybody who's doing this is going against the grain of human history. And psychedelics are the same way, that the more we dig into ancient cultures and religions and histories, we're finding that human beings have been using psychedelics for thousands of years.
Yeah, no, I've talked to a few people on this podcast, most recently Kalindi EE, and he was talking about that. He's done a lot of research on past cultures and use of mushrooms, and it's just fascinating to just hear him talk about it. Like, there's so many past cultures that seem to have links to some kind of psychedelic drug. And
yeah, so we're just in denial if we think, oh, well, we can just say that it's bad and it's wrong and we're going to put everybody who does this in jail and then we're just going to get rid of this from society.
Right.
That's a fool's errand. It's not going to work. All you're going to do is end up bankrupting your society by putting people into jail.
And the funny thing is, like, I have these conversations with people, like very similar conversations all the time. And it seems like, I don't know if it's just my network that I'm communicating with, but it seems like 90% of the people I talk to agree. They think like a lot of these drugs should be legal, especially marijuana. Like that's the easy one sort of these days. But even when I start talking about mushrooms with people, and as soon as even if they're not into psychedelics, if I just start telling them how I use it, like, oh yeah, I know it helps me sort of like deal with issues and whatever, whatever. They're like, oh yeah, that sounds reasonable. That should probably be legal. But the thing is, it seems like it's taking so long. Do you have any kind of insight as to like, how can we speed up this process to make these legal already? How do we get this done?
Well, just going back to what you said before in the sense of coming out of the closet and making information available and freely talking about it, and especially people sharing their positive experiences and what they feel they've gained from this.
Right.
Because otherwise it's in this nebulous dark box where people can put all their projections onto it about what they think is bad or wrong or evil about it. And just spreading that information around, and that's what creates a tipping point. And especially, I mean, everybody knows hippies do drugs, okay?
Yeah.
That's fine. But like in my time at the Santo Daime Church, because I went there for about a year and a quarter, kind of irregularly attending their works. One of the things that really impressed me there is that almost everybody there was in their 50s, 60s, and 70s, and none of them fit my image of the, quote, psychedelic user. So I was very surprised. I was like, wow, this is like grandma and grandpa over here, and that was very eye-opening for me that, you know, the things that I'd been exposed to previously, it was kind of more in the hippie counterculture, things like that, where, okay, the guy's got the dreadlocks and the beard and he's, you know, got the tie-dye shirt. You know, you can pretty much bet that that person is taking psychedelics. But these are people who are business owners, they're family members. These are just, quote, normal members of society. And I think having people like that admit to their use helps normalize it in society. It's kind of like with Steve Jobs, saying that taking LSD was among the most important things he's ever done in his life. And like right now, Silicon Valley, man,
I've heard stories.
They don't talk about it too much, but they're all tripping. That's what is driving the tech industry. And there's been
Silicon Valley, like for people who aren't familiar, like that's where it's like Google headquarters and all these kind of folks.
Yeah, Google, Apple, you know, all of these tech companies. So this is a particular area in California. And all of these people now, they're all getting hooked into the Burning Man culture. Mm-hmm. There's also been the rapid spread of the use of 5-MeO-DMT among people in the tech industry. So people are going into really deep, profound states, and then they're bringing that back and using that to help design the next artificial intelligence or computer program. You know, I mean, it's not a coincidence that when you turn on your iTunes visualizer, that it looks pretty psychedelic. There's a reason for that. It's because these people are inspired by their experiences, and they're using that to help shape the way that we're using modern technology. Right. And so I think people admitting that and saying, well, yeah, this is actually an important part of our business model, that we go on retreat to Burning Man and we spend a week tripping out in the desert and seeing and experience things that we've never seen or experienced before. And then we're bringing that novelty back into the workspace and using that explosion of creativity to design the next computer system.
Right. So that's like what you were talking about before, is the potential these things have is not only just for like healing or like sort of the scientific model of treating an illness, even though that's a lot of people sort of like to look at it that way and they find more comfort in looking at it. But it's also just creativity, just bringing stuff back and putting that out into the world. It seems like they have a huge role to play in just how that goes, just creating things.
Yeah. And especially, again, when we're looking at human history, that, okay, so for example, when people take, especially, visually powerful psychedelics, it's really common for people to see statues and art and architecture. And so here's my own particular view, that some people say, oh, well, I visited ancient Egypt, right? I went to ancient Egypt in this trip and I saw the pyramids. I actually completely disagree with that. I don't think anybody's going anywhere. I think that these are all just things that are projected in the mind at the moment. But what I think that does indicate is that a lot of human architecture throughout history actually has been inspired by psychedelics. Right. That, you know, we have ancient Egyptians that are tripping on psychedelics that are available in that area of the world. And maybe they're seeing pyramids and they're seeing all this fantastic statuary. And then someone gets the idea, is like, we should build this stuff. Because it's one thing to see it in the visionary state. It's another thing then to turn it into physical, tangible form. And that's kind of the role of human beings. So I call the visionary state is the divine imagination. So these are God's ideas just kind of floating around like, hey, pyramid looks pretty cool, huh? Do you want to make that? And then it's up to human beings to actually actualize that. And especially when people talk about UFOs, aliens, higher technology, that I do think that psychedelics are kind of driving technological innovation. Sure. That it's not that people are seeing alien technology. They're seeing the possibilities for future human technology. And so this is kind of a wellspring of ideas. And I think that this is something that's been at play throughout human history.
Right. It's kind of like that chicken or the egg sort of argument sometimes. Because I hear a lot of people talk about Mayan stuff too. They're like, yeah, I took mushrooms and then I saw this Mayan imagery or Aztec stuff going on. And it's like, well, maybe you are seeing Aztec stuff, or maybe you're just seeing what the Aztecs saw and they brought that back. You know, it's not like their stuff got uploaded. It's like they download or whatever, you know?
Yeah. So yeah. It's the directionality that Maya and Aztec cultures made use of a variety of different psilocybin mushrooms. And so, of course, you take psilocybin mushrooms and the patterning, the geometry, the imagery that you see reminds you of these cultures, but that's because they saw it first and then they built it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. It's not that you're traveling back in time or something that. You're just seeing the same basic blueprints that were accessible to them because this is the universal mind that we're all sharing and partaking of as we're experiencing psychedelics.
Right. So that's something we can get into because I know you have, like you've touched on this a little bit already, is that you have your own theory and you're not, like you've participated in the past with things like Santo Daime and different sort of religious or spiritual practices with shamanism type things, but you've sort of pushed that aside and moved on and you have your own theory now. But I think before I get into that, I just want to make the point that like, we started out just talking about the potential these things have to help people. And I think right now, in our current situation, I think that's the most important thing to focus. Like, no matter what they are, like whether they are a link to the spiritual realm or their God or their whatever, either way, they can really help people. They can do a lot of good, whether it's treating cluster headaches or treating anxiety and depression. So no matter what they are, they're very helpful. And I hope that they can be used by a lot more people. But it is also very interesting to start talking about what they actually are then, because there's a lot of different ideas out there. And so your idea basically is this idea of the non-dual. Maybe, do you want to just sort of summarize what you believe that to be about?
Yeah, so that actually gets me into the third model of psychedelic therapy. And that's what I would call the non-dual model. And I also like to call it a therapeutic model because I like to distinguish it from, again, the religious, spiritual, and shamanic use of these substances. Because under this model, the basic idea is that there is only one being that actually exists. And I like to use the word God. And a lot of people, they bristle up like, oh, why do you have to use that word? And it's like, well, for me, that's the best word that fits. So I'm going to use it. But I'm not coming from any kind of biblical tradition or religious tradition. It's like I got an email the other day from some young guy in the Philippines who came across my work online, and his question were around like, well, is the scientific model of reality, is that compatible with the religious revelations of the Bible and the divinity of Jesus? And so I had to write him back. It's like, look, man, I'm not the person you think I am, because I think the Bible is just a bunch of stories. I don't even think Jesus is a real person historically. I don't think he even existed as an individual. So, you're asking the wrong person here if you want some kind of confirmation that supports your biblical view. So anyway, I use the word God, but I'm not coming from a Christian tradition, a Jewish tradition, Islamic tradition, a Hindu tradition. By God, I mean an all-encompassing entity or being that is all of reality itself. So I call my position a radical non-dual perspective. In religious studies, that might also be called a panentheist, which again is this position that God actually is everyone and everything. That all of reality is God, is this one being. And it's not some transcendent being that's somewhere out there in the universe looking down on us that is creating things that are separate from itself, but that reality actually is the ongoing process of self-transformation that is God. Right. And that each individual human being is God embodied. And so that means that there are no saints or sinners, there's no saviors, there's no one that's more holy than anybody else, because we're basically just robots that are walking around thinking that I'm me and you're you and we're separate, that's an illusion created by the human ego. And then when you strip all that away, it's just God underneath. That's the non-dual thing.
Like the duality is thinking I'm me and you're you, or I'm me, and that's a spirit or a ghost. I'm me, that's an alien, or whatever, like separating yourself from everything around you. When the idea, and this is something like a lot of people experience this maybe to a smaller extent, with a lot of like this idea of that we're all just connected in a way. We're all connected by love and whatever. That's the hippie sort of idea. And I felt that with mushrooms too, is this thing that I felt is just sort of more connected to the world around me than I thought I was.
Like yeah.
Whether it's with a tree or it's with whatever the hell is going on with patterns and stuff. And I've been trying to sort of wrap my head around this idea of the non-dual, and maybe you can tell me if this works or not. This, I've been thinking about this is like, it's kind of like if our body is the universe and we're like a little, maybe like a white blood cell, or because we have things living inside of our bodies.
So yeah.
Our bodies are made up of living organisms and things in the gut. So it's kind of like if a little white blood cell thought, oh, I'm just a blood cell. I'm just by myself doing my work and whatever, when really it's part of this huge system that's actually a being, and it's the being too. It is me. But right. It's also, it's kind of like that on a bigger scale. Does that make
yeah,
sense?
On the biggest scale. Right. And there certainly are levels to non-dual realization. And so kind of the early levels of realization is the idea of, oh, I'm a part of everything else. I'm connected to everything else. But there's still that sense of I
yeah.
and everything else,
sure.
right? So that I'm a part of it and I feel connected to it. And my radical non-duality just goes all the way and says, nope, you're God. Actually, you're not just connected to everything else. You are everything else. That's right. The true nature of identity. And so that includes the computer here in front of me. It includes the light and the air and the room, that all of these things actually are the self. That's the only thing that genuinely exists. And so we have the appearance of discrete objects and discrete entities within our experience, but these are just different characters and manifestations of this one universal being. And because I've accepted that, I've also rejected the notion of individual souls. That for me is a concept that just makes no sense. If every person actually is God, well, what are you talking about when you say my soul? Because that's duality. That's holding on to some kind of individual sense of identity. And for me, that's just an illusion, which means I also reject things like karma and reincarnation and past lives and future lives. It's like, no, there's only one being that is all beings right now. That's the only being that's, quote, reincarnating. There's no individual trajectory
right.
of my consciousness is reincarnating from life to life. I reject that's just an illusion. That's a holdover of the ego wanting to say that its identity somehow exists other than as this temporary configuration of space, time, and energy that happens to say, hello, I'm here.
Right. So I have a few questions about this idea. So one is that like you can have this experience and feel this, but then you come back and we are separate. Like I'm talking to you. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, you can't really live in that state all the time. So what does it mean? How does it affect your life to have an experience that is, you feel that you are completely connected to everything and you are God, if you will. And how does that affect your day to day?
Okay, that's a great question, because just having that complete non-dual experience, that's great. It has really limited value other than it kind of gives you a baseline so you can say, okay, well, I guess that's what reality is. But then, yeah, the real question is day-to-day living. I mean, it's one thing if you want to be a monk and seal yourself off in a cave and just spend the rest of your life meditating. Most people don't have that luxury or that indulgence. We've got to deal with day-to-day stuff. Now, the practical side of this is that the ego, the sense of self, the sense of separation, can then be understood as a part of yourself, but it's not yourself. So the way that I would describe it is that because everyone is actually just a character for God to act through, these identities are just false constructs. And the problem is that through the ego, we identify with that character. So this actually becomes like a mental health issue in the sense, like if you have an actor that's playing a role in a movie, if that actor becomes convinced that he is that character,
yeah.
we would say, you don't understand reality, that you're living in a fantasy world. You're living in a mistaken projection of who and what it is that you think that you are. And then you're living your life according to that, but you're not that character. You're actually this person.
Right.
Now, so I'm taking it a step further and saying, you are not actually the person you think you are. That is a character that you are playing as God. Now, so from the practical perspective, because we think we are these characters, we become very attached to these characters, and that we also get attached to the illusion of the character, and we project onto ourselves and onto others and onto objects, and we get invested in this identity. And if something threatens this identity, then that causes all kinds of problems for both ourselves and for others. I mean, just take a good look at what's going on in the Middle East right now. We have the Islamic State, which are Sunni Muslims, which is an identity. Mm-hmm. They're going around and they're killing every last Shiite Muslim they can find within their territory because those other people have the wrong identity.
Right.
So that is the problem of actually identifying with our ego constructs and this narrative that we create that says, I am me, and this me has this relationship to God or the universe or the ultimate, whatever that is, and God is demanding of me to do these things in order to purify the earth or whatever it is, that virtually all of our social problems extend out of these addictions and attachments of the ego.
So yeah, and it becomes a sort of non-attachment idea is a sort of like one of the benefits, I guess, of experiencing this non-duality. But it's hard. So have there ever been like a culture that actually practices this, or a religious group? Like, it's, Buddhism is like kind of close, I guess, in a way, because they practice that non-attachment idea. But I guess Buddhism has does it have reincarnation? Is that in Buddhism? Yeah.
Yeah.
You're the religious professor. I'll let you tell me. But is there anyone who actually practices this in your sort of theory of it?
No. Certain strains of Taoism and Buddhism and, say, Advaita Vedanta and, say, Sufism and Islam, they would come closer than anything else. But those often are just, they're small pockets within larger social identities and religious identities. And so it hasn't actually been enacted on any kind of really widespread scale. And also the problem with the ego, that because it is attached to these illusions, that we get all these energetic distortions within ourselves. And this is why when people take psychedelics and their ego starts to weaken a little bit, they start throwing up or whatever it is, because we've stored all this crap inside of ourselves through our attachments to our identities. And that creates mental, emotional, and physical imbalances within the body. So we can clear all those out. But I would say this has not happened at a very large scale level. So, I mean, like even with Buddhists, they're still Buddhists, right? That's still an identity that comes with a certain set of symbols, a certain set of beliefs, a certain set of practices.
It's like, it almost seems impossible not to have that in a little bit. Like, to just, I guess, is that like, do you imagine this is like the singularity? Is everyone coming to this point where this is realization that we're all connected on this divine level, and we all just come to some state of like being with no fluctuation of attachment or ego desire or whatever, however you want to put it?
Well, that would be the ideal. You know, whether that's really going to happen at a large scale across societies and cultures, I mean, I'm not one to try and predict the future, so I don't know. I mean, that's certainly what inspires me, is the thought of, look, if we can get as many people as possible to detach their identities from their egos, that the world is actually going to be a much healthier and happier place. And we're at a point where this is really, really important, because here we are, we're going around the world, we're killing each other over these stupid little identity issues. I believe the right thing, you believe the wrong thing. I mean, that's just ego talking to itself and engaging in these games of destruction and killing. Mm-hmm. And look, we're facing massive environmental catastrophe. And like here in the United States, environmental issues are always wrapped up in identity. We've got Republicans against Democrats, against liberals. And so it's all just these egos and identities battling each other.
Right.
And no one's dealing with the actual fact that we're headed towards massive, massive trouble Because we have got climate change, we've got shifting weather patterns, we've got drought, we've got mega floods, we've got sea level rise coming. I mean, right. It's time to set the shit aside and do the real work, because we're in serious, serious trouble right now. And it's only going to get worse. And the more attached we are to our identities of who's right and who's wrong, who's chosen, who's not chosen, the more we're going to, I mean, it's like going back to the thing earlier saying that, well, look, okay, you got cancer, maybe you're going to die. It's your attitude about it that is really most important. And that's why psychedelic therapy is good for people with cancer. Well, it's the same thing. We are now facing an unprecedented environmental catastrophe across this planet. And the more people put their projections and illusions based on their ego on top of that, the more difficult it is to actually get anything done that might be beneficial to serve humanity. So the more we can get people outside of that ego, the better. Because when people are trapped in the ego, they're coming from a place of confusion. Again, it's like an actor mistakenly thinking that he is a character in a movie. You can't expect him to make rational, reasonable decisions based on reality, because he's not living in reality. And so right. People who are living exclusively in their egos also are not living in reality. They're living in a fantasy world. Now, This does not mean that I advocate the idea of just getting rid of the ego, that I look at the ego as kind of like clothing. And I'm not saying everyone needs to walk around naked all the time. But if you think that you are the clothing that you're wearing, You're mistaken. And then if somehow your clothing gets torn or removed, then you're in this whole identity crisis. Wait, who am I? And the ego is like clothing. It's something that helps facilitate social interaction. So there's nothing inherently wrong with it. It's just built upon lies upon lies upon lies upon illusions upon projections upon attachments. And so it creates these distortions where people are not able to actually interact authentically and rationally. And so I see this as the potential for really healing this problem of the ego and the negative consequences that arise from people mistaking their egos for themselves. And that if we could do this on a large scale, that it is only going to benefit humanity.
Right. So it's like this idea. It's like you can have attachments, but don't be too attached to your attachments. It's almost like you kind of have to have like a level of faith in just the universe itself and just how things work out, to not, like, if your house burns down and you lose everything, you could be devastated, or you could kind of just be like, well, okay, I'm going to rebuild and it's going to be okay, and something is going to come my way and I'm going to get out of this and it'll be fine. Because in the end, it's the same idea. Like if you're dying of cancer, if you only know yourself and believe that you are you, and if you die, you're gone. And oh my, like that's a scary, scary thought. But if you have an experience where you feel like you are attached to everything else and that you are everything else, that you're going to in some way or another, go back to what, like the source, or you're going to, you still exist because you exist in everything. So one little actor is not going to, you know, affect you forever, sort of.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like when a cell in your body dies, it's like, well, you're still here. Yeah. That cell's gone.
You can build more cells.
Yeah. But you're still here. And so given that our true nature is God, it doesn't really matter what happens to the individual cells in a sense, because God isn't going anywhere.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. So this idea, you have this idea of God, but it still doesn't answer. I mean, I guess none of them, like I was going to say, it doesn't really answer any questions. You still don't know where God comes from or what it means to be God, or if there are multiple gods or if there's only one. I mean, I'm assuming you're saying there's only one. But and I was going to sort of compare it to like shamanism, like it's funny because you go around and you talk at a lot of these conferences, like psychedelic conferences, and I would probably say 90% of the people, I mean, I don't really know, but probably a lot of the people at these conferences are coming from a shamanistic point of view, where they're talking about interacting with spirits or entities of some kind. You must kind of have I don't know if you have a great wrap around all these folks, because you're basically telling them all that they're wrong, right? You're saying there are no spirits you're interacting with.
It's kind of funny. So There's kind of two reactions that I get. One is people getting angry and defending their identities, saying, no, I believe in these spirits, this is my tradition or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so people get offended really easily. That's another thing about the ego. It's really, really easy to offend. I mean, it's like shooting fish in a barrel. I mean, it's right. not hard to
do. What about you though? Like, would you be prepared what if you were wrong about this? What if you were wrong? Would you be prepared to just accept that too? Or that might be hard as well, right?
No, I would accept it if that's
proven to you and like legitimately.
And I would say if it was proven within myself. But see, here's the thing about the non-dual state, that genuinely entering into the non-dual state is beyond these other more dualistic states of perceptions of self and other. And when you really go into that, it puts everything else into a context and perspective. It's like, oh, here I thought I was interacting with some being that's outside of myself, but now I've gone deeper and realizing I'm just projecting that.
Right.
And so I don't know what it would be to prove anything otherwise to me at this point. Because
I've got a story for you, actually, that I'd like your opinion on. And you can feel free to hurt my feelings if you disagree. So
okay.
I went and did ayahuasca just for the first time the last year. Went to Peru to do it. Went with a large group. There was like 25 people at this retreat I was at.
Sure.
And so I went down. We did ayahuasca four separate times. And I had one experience in particular that was like my sort of the big experience that I got. I took the most that night and whatever. I took a lot. And I had an experience where this is the only time I've done mushrooms for a long, long time. I've never had any experience of meeting any kind of being or entity or spirit or anything. But this one night I had three little, white spirits that I could feel like doing something to my head. Like my head started buzzing and I could feel these little spirits. And I had never, heard of these things before. But then the next day I was talking to people at breakfast. And so another guy there, he was like, oh man, on another night, I saw those exact same spirits. And I thought that was really interesting. Okay, you saw the same, we described them sort of bits at a time, and it was clear we felt the same things. And I asked the shaman guy there about it, and he calls them Dr. Sitos, which is like the little doctors. Have you ever heard of these things with ayahuasca?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so, and then there was a third person who had also experienced these, and I had never heard about these things before the experience.
Right.
So how can you explain that?
There's only one mind that is experiencing all of these things.
Okay.
You see, because you're still coming from the position that, well, I'm separate from these other people. And if they saw something that I saw, it must mean that we're confirming that we're actually seeing the same thing. But if you look at it as, well, actually, this is just one universal consciousness that is experiencing itself simultaneously from different perspectives. Mm-hmm. Well, then that's not a problem because it's all drawing from the same well, in a sense.
So like a certain experience might, like if we have a certain experience and we have a similar mindset or something, that might draw in the same feeling of having those entities.
Yeah. Yeah. Hmm. And especially when working in some kind of group context, people's energies are going to be influencing each other within that context. And so then there's the likelihood of shared experience arising within that. It's just, again, is when you go beyond the sense of we're separate, and then you start to think, well, actually, we're all just one consciousness experiencing itself simultaneously from different perspectives, then it totally makes sense that the same kind of content and experience would pop up in different perspectives, either simultaneously or at different times, because it's all just one consciousness.
Right. So we'll see the same illusions.
Essentially. And that we can call it the energetic constructs of the mind or human psychology, that there are certain ways that it works that then are amplified and are demonstrated through the psychedelic experience. And that sometimes, especially if there is doctoring that needs to take place, it's just more effective if the illusion of self and other is maintained, because then yourself, your ego sense of self can say, hey, oh, they're working on me. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I'll let them work on me. And it allows you to relax into the experience in a way that it becomes effective. Hmm. Now, from the non-dual perspective, you can say, well, I'm playing this game with myself where I'm pretending to be both the client and the doctors at the same time. And if that's what I need in order to effectively get a healing, so be it. You know, there's nothing necessarily wrong with that. It's when we start reifying that, you know, when a lot of people who work with spirits and stuff like that, they say, well, the spirits told me this, and so now I need to do this, or, you know, something along those lines. Mm-hmm. And that is the potential for a lot of confusion games. Because if you don't really understand that it's yourself telling you these things, you know, or like a lot of times when people talk about ayahuasca, they say, wow, ayahuasca knew things about myself yeah. and knew things about me right. that I didn't even know. Oh. How did it do that? How did it know these most intimate details about myself that I've forgotten or didn't realize about myself? How does it know more about me? Mm-hmm. And if you say, well, it's because it just is you, then right. it makes sense. It's me at a more conscious level, and it's interacting with me at a less conscious level. And it has to do that through characters and scenery and environments, because that's all that myself is going to take at that time period. But in moving beyond that, it's beyond the visionary realm. There is no sense of self and other in the non-dual state. There is simply the pure nature of being. Right. And there's no subject or object there. It's just the isness right. of being.
So isn't there a little bit of a danger with taking a non-dual perspective on everything? It seems like maybe if you got caught up thinking like, okay, so we're all the same. We're all from the same place. And the good people, like the rapists and murderers, they're me. And we're all in this together. And we're all – and nothing – it kind of gets to a point where – you can almost say, well, nothing really matters then. Like, it doesn't matter if we go out and kill people, because we're going to go back to the same thing in the end anyway. Or like, where does the motivation then come to like do good or be a better person?
Okay. Well, that's the horror of non-duality. You know, a lot of times people think non-duality is, oh, well, it's all love. So it's all just great. And we can all just be nice to each other. No, actually, it's terribly horrifying, because it does mean nothing means anything. There is no moral compass to the universe or to mm-hmm. God. There is no right or wrong. There is no punishment. There's no reward. It's all up to us. And so that's the horrifying nature of the non-dual perspective. And that really accepting that God doesn't give a shit who wins or loses, who lives or who dies, because God is all the characters. And so it's kind of irrelevant.
Yeah, that's okay. Kind of a scary thought, because
it is.
Like, well, let's go start a gang and mess some shit up, right?
Okay, but the other side of that is the paradoxical nature that, yes, we are everyone and everything, but we still experience ourselves from embodied, limited perspectives as individuals. That's the great paradox of being. You are God, and you're also you mm-hmm. as an individual. And so meaning then is something that is generated from the individual. Now, it's a mistake if we superimpose meaning onto the universe or onto reality to say this means this and that means that and this is right and that is wrong. And we're superimposing that at an exterior level. But if we take responsibility for it, we say, well, it matters to me from this perspective. Okay. So everything is God. Everything is actually cool all the time. But me, from my perspective, it still matters if I'm able to drink clean water and breathe clean air.
Right. So now, you still accept that you can sort of have that level of understanding too. Like you can
yes.
you can still have the ego, as you call it, you know?
Yeah. And that it's just about honoring and recognizing that this comes from personal preference and personal perspective. Okay. Mm-hmm. So like, for example, someone says, well, I'm a good Christian. I read the Bible and God hates fags. And so gay marriage is wrong because God hates fags. Now, that is superimposing meaning at the exterior level and saying that there is some kind of top-down authority that decides what's right or wrong. The responsible way to say that is, I hate fags.
I don't like
it. I am opposed to gay marriage, and so I'm going to act against right. it. But trying to put it off on God or the Bible or the Quran or the Torah or the Vedas or right. the sutras, trying to put it off on an exterior authority, that's where the illusion lies. Right. So it's okay that things matter to you, but just be honest about it and say, well, it matters to me because this is my preference. Right. And your preference is not necessarily anybody else's preference.
Right. That's something that I think the psychedelics do have the power to do, is sort of help people take responsibility for their own lives, for their own like healing and stuff too. And that's, I think, some of the power and some of the healing effects they have is you sort of realize like you have the power to change things and to decide for yourself and not just say like, not just get hung up on like, oh, fuck the government. The government's corrupt and I don't want to do anything because I don't trust these guys and this is bullshit and fuck them and fuck this guy and this guy's an asshole. And I don't like, it's just kind of like, okay, well, I can just choose to change my life or I can choose to live how I want and perceive things the way I want to. And if you want to choose to be a good person too, this is something that I've felt is when you do see someone who's like being an asshole, instead of just saying, oh, that guy is an asshole and fuck that guy, you can just go, well, that guy has some problems and I should probably try to help that guy not be that way. Because if he's an extension of me, I feel embarrassed that he's acting that way. So I got to like help this dude figure his stuff out kind of thing.
Yeah. So this is one of the ironies again, that in recognizing non-duality, it's like, well, actually everything's okay. Okay. Because it's all just God doing its thing. But since it matters to me, and the more I center within the reality of myself, the more open my heart becomes, the greater my compassion extends to all beings and all things and all times, that it actually makes you a better person. So that the likelihood that you are then going to go out and support genocide and murder and all of these things that are creating suffering, that becomes less and less and less and less and less. So you're simultaneously accepting that everything's okay.
Yeah.
But then energetically, from a place of authenticity, those are no longer things that you want to support or be involved in any way. And your compassion motivates you to then do something about it. But it's not coming from a top-down moral system that I'm doing this because I think I should. I'm doing it because I feel it. I feel compassion for this individual or this group of people or whoever they are. And so I'm motivated to act based on how I feel within myself, not because I think it's right, not because I think it's what I should do or what I have to do. I do it because I'm actually compelled and motivated to do it.
Right.
So it does make people, quote, more moral. It makes them more compassionate. It makes them more empathetic and sympathetic. But it comes from a place of authenticity rather than saying, well, I read it in a book, so I've got to do it this way.
Right. You're taking responsibility for the way that you feel about matters instead of saying, well, this is illegal and this is legal. This is what God says. This is what the Bible says. This is what someone else is telling me.
Yeah, it's removing all of those third-person authorities, whether you think it's God or Jesus or Buddha or Allah or the spirits or the ancestors or your karma or your past life. It's taking all of those places that we displace responsibility onto others and saying, no, actually, it's up to me.
Right.
It's up to me in every moment. It's up to me what I choose to do with myself. I either choose to be authentic and genuine and with a loving and open heart, or I'm going to be something else. And if other people are not being that way, then it extends my compassion to them because really I just see another version of myself suffering. And I love myself. I want to take care of myself as best I can so that I will be compassionate towards others.
Right.
And sometimes that means challenging people, especially when they're attached to their illusions and their projections, kind of like what you were going back to saying earlier when I speak at these conferences, that sometimes I really piss other people off. And then the flip side of that is that other people come up afterwards and they say, I've never heard anybody talk about this way before. And it's like a breath of fresh air. And it's completely reorienting me towards all of my experiences and everything I ever thought. And I'm feeling liberated that something's happening here. And so people who are ready to hear this, it will really resonate with them. For people who want to be attached to their illusions and their projections and their third person authorities, that's up to them. It's going to make them uncomfortable and it's going to make them feel self-conscious. And, you know, that's not always fun for me because sometimes people yell and scream at me and, you know, write me nasty things on the internet. And that kind of comes with the territory.
Mm-hmm. No, so. I like the idea, and like I really hadn't thought about it in this way until I had started reading and hearing your work. What I like about it really is that it challenges all these other ideas. It puts the burden of proof out there. Like how do you prove? Either way, it's hard to prove non-duality, and it's hard to prove duality. Really, you can't really, it seems like, actually prove it like legitimately. And I have another question too, is just if you have an experience, and I know you talk about 5-MeO-DMT being like sort of the substance to have this non-dual experience with, but even if you have this experience, how do you know that that experience then translates to everything and then that is the truth of the universe or whatever? Like, how do you just, because I've had experiences on mushrooms that were very profound at the time, very like, and I thought it was the truth. I talked about one in particular. Before I talked to Kalindi, I decided I'm going to take a high dose mushroom trip because he's the guy to talk about it with. So I took like 15 grams of mushrooms and had this whole like profound mind-blowing thing. But then as I came down and sort of went through it afterward, I realized some of it was delusional. Like it was for sure a bit delusional at the time. Yeah. So how do you know that what you're experiencing just for this brief moment is the truth?
Well, that's a difficult question to answer. And it's not, see, I always try and reorient away from a mental realization to an energetic reality. And that the more you can center on what you feel rather than what you think, then the closer that you are to the truth. And can I prove non-duality to anybody else? Absolutely not. It's just, it's not possible. But I do hold the position that if you experience non-duality for yourself, you will probably come to agree with the position that I'm advocating here, because it does present itself as fundamental and absolute, and that everything else arises from this non-dual state of being. And, you know, maybe you've been lost in duality your whole life, and the second you actually fall all the way into non-duality, it puts everything else in perspective, and you realize, oh man, I've just been telling myself stories about all this. I've been projecting. I've been having attachments. And then as you let those go, you feel more true within yourself. You feel more authentic. So it comes back down to feeling, which, you know, a lot of people don't like that because they say, no, you got to be rational. We got to prove it. Yeah. And, you know, there's room for that. But I mean, on the other side of it is, you know, there's no scientific evidence, for example, that souls exist.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, you know? All of that kind of stuff is just sort of unprovable at this point.
Right? And now many neuroscientists are saying, well, there actually isn't anyone inside your head making decisions that you think are your own, and that most of our behaviors and activities are subconscious patterns, and that it's only after the fact that this little narrator comes in and says, oh, I made that decision. Yeah. Okay. So even from a scientific perspective, they can't find the self.
Right.
Right. So I think that there's plenty of evidence that there isn't an actual self. There's not a soul or essential being that is you. So I think that that supports the non-dual position. And given that, so since there is no soul that can be identified, it also indicates that biological life forms are made out of the same stuff as non-biological life forms. And then that raises the question, well, how is that possible? Because if I'm alive and a rock is not alive, where does that livingness come from? And so my answer to that is, well, it's just because everything is God and we're just a different configuration of energy that allows us to be conscious and self-aware and, quote, alive. But we don't have to introduce the notion of some kind of living essence. Right. Into the individual.
Some sort of animator or animated spirit or some.
Right. Something. Right. Yeah. So that I think that the non-dual position actually fits quite nicely with contemporary science, whereas I think duality and more a spiritualized view, I think, doesn't necessarily fit very well with empirical science. So I think that the facts tend to support non-duality, but ultimately is you either experience it or you don't. And part of the difficulty is that, you know, we can talk a lot about it, but every concept we have is a concept based in duality. And so you can't understand what the non-dual experience is. I cannot explain it to you through language and conceptuality. If someone has the experience, they can say, okay, I think I know what you're talking about now. But until you have that experience, it's just a concept. And so this is the way that it was for me in being educated and having my PhD in religious studies. I'd studied comparative mysticism You know, so I'd read all these different accounts and read all these different traditions. And I had an intellectual understanding that if someone asked me, do you think that everything is one? I would say, yes. And then if you ask me, well, have you experienced that directly? I'd say, no, but I think that that's true.
Right.
And then when I actually had the experience, I realized I had no idea what it actually is. And that experience allowed me to then start to process through all the illusions and attachments of my ego.
So
things that I didn't know were illusions and attachments until I went through that experience and started to realize, oh, I've been bullshitting myself about a lot of stuff, and that's been creating a lot of issues for me. So now let's begin the process of clearing these things out.
In that way, you are sort of taking a shaman-like approach, just in the way that they talk about just personal experience being the teacher, and that you can't really teach someone. You have to just experience it yourself. And that's kind of sort of at the core of a lot of shaman cultures.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm just saying, well, let's take it even further, because most shamanism still exists within this realm of duality, and it's possible to go beyond that. You know, right. Like, this is one of the big things that Buddhism brought to Asia, where all throughout rural Asia, shamanism predominated. Mm. And then Buddhism came in and said, well, actually, there's a level of consciousness and reality and being that's beyond all this stuff that you guys are talking about. And so that's kind of how Buddhism characterizes itself, that, well, yeah, there was shamanism, but let's take that shamanism and let's move it into the non-dual. And the real melding of shamanism and Buddhism became Vajrayana Buddhism or Tantric Buddhism, that has all kinds of spirits and deities and entities and realms. But the end result of Tantric Buddhism is Dzogchen, which is the great perfection. Which says, okay, so all of these things we've been teaching you about all of these entities and beings and realms, they're all just you. And it's all just the pure white light of the mind. So there actually aren't any separate entities and realms and all of this. It's just the Buddha mind. You are the Buddha mind. You always have been the Buddha mind. And these are just manifestations of the mind. And that to understand the self, you need to move into these deeper realms. Because in these more dualistic realms, people aren't necessarily asking themselves the question, who is the one perceiving the others and the objects? It's like, whoa, I'm talking to spirits. I must be a shaman. Well, who are you essentially? What are you underneath the story of this dualistic interaction? So it's asking you to really question that. And that's why the non-dual process is also known as a deconstructive process. It's taking your beliefs and your ideas of what you think is and is not, and just dismantling them, dismantling them, right. Dismantling them, dismantling them, and then seeing what you're left with after you've deconstructed everything that you think that you know. That there's just, oh, there's just universal consciousness and being. That's what it's always been.
That is what it seems like. After hearing you describe it a lot, is it sort of just like shedding layer after layer after layer, just getting to the core beneath all these little games and whatnot that we play. But I want to ask you about these substances. So I know that you talk about 5-MeO, DMT being like the, I mean, you really go hard as like, that's the be all end all. That's the one that's going to give you this the best experience kind of thing. But what do you think then all of these others like mushrooms and LSD and even something like MDMA, what is the role that these have? If the ultimate sort of goal is to get to this non-dual state, do these, because you can get close with some of these other things. Do you think that they all kind of point in that same direction a little bit? Or
I do. And I think that they're all good and they're all useful and viable. The difficulty is that the ego is tremendously resilient and resourceful. And it's very, 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 very difficult to actually fully overcome the structures of the ego. It's not easy to do. And so if we're looking for the non-dual experience, 5-MeO DMT is the best because it's the most powerful. Now, that's not to say that there's anything wrong with these other medicines. It's just that it's much easier for the ego to reconfigure and hold on when using these less powerful medicines. So if we really want to get into the non-dual state, 5-MeO DMT is simply the most effective. It's just a practical issue. Now, once someone gets a baseline of experience in the non-dual, then that helps put everything else into perspective. And so it's not that I think that people should only do 5-MeO-DMT or that they just need to stick with that and that everything else is worthless. I think that there's a, I mean, I personally have not met a medicine that I have not thoroughly enjoyed and loved in many, many ways. But the non-dual approach is really made more efficacious by the more powerful the medicine. And there isn't anything anywhere near as powerful as 5-MeO-DMT. Right. It's just hands down. I mean, not even DMT gets anywhere close to 5-MeO-DMT. I mean, a lot of people walk around like, oh, DMT is the greatest thing ever. It's like, no, 5-MeO-DMT is way more profound.
Right. So I want to ask you about like the difference there. But first, I just want to touch on something you said. When I had this delusional experience on mushrooms, I was kind of trying to figure out like, why the hell did I get so, how did I get so delusional? And I thought maybe part of it, I mean, I was just trying to rationalize it. So I don't know, this might not make sense, but I had this super high dose experience and I feel like what was happening is my consciousness or maybe my ego, as you say, was trying to make sense of it. So I was just trying to put it into boxes and just be like, okay, I think it's this happening and this is the singularity and this is something happening right here. And then afterward, I was like, what the hell was I thinking? Like, how did I get so tricked down that road? And maybe it is just, I didn't quite get far enough to really dissolve ever, to just break through totally, where I was still trying to put things into categories and like make sense of everything.
Yeah, then that's one of the habitual actions of the ego, that it's always trying to categorize things. And that's, I mean, when people really get a good dose of 5-MeO-DMT, it's really common for people to describe it as feeling like they're just completely losing their mind and completely going insane, that nothing makes sense anymore. And there's just this sense of just completely shattering the conceptuality of the mind. And then it's just pure being, and there's no thought about it. It's just pure being in that moment. And that's what I mean, that we actually need enough energy to break these structures of the ego because they're very, very resilient. I mean, that's their job, is to be resilient and tenacious. And it takes a lot to actually break them down. And another advantage to 5-MeO-DMT versus some of these other ones is that by comparison, it's relatively less visual. And the more visual something is, the more easily someone can get locked into a dualistic sense, because I am seeing something that seems to exist out there somewhere. So it preserves this sense of self and other, of subject and object. Whereas 5-MeO, since it's not very visual, but it's tremendously overpowering energetically, there's just this sense that all these things are breaking apart, breaking apart, breaking apart, and then it's just expanding into infinite nothingness. Right. And there's not like, there's not someone there, there's not an alien there saying, hey, hello, glad you made it. Yeah. There's nothing there. It's just this emptiness that's profoundly full at the same time, and it cannot be conceptualized by the mind. And so that's what makes it effective for that work. But it's, we just have to recognize that it's very, very difficult to actually break free of all of the bonds of the ego. And then even with 5-MeO-DMT, even if someone goes all the way beyond the ego, at most that's going to last 15 minutes. And then as soon as the energy starts going down, the ego just goes clink, 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 and just comes right back in, because it's this resilient little bugger that will do anything it can to hold on to its sense of self.
Right. Yeah, it's funny when you talk about it not being visual. I know people who maybe don't have experience with psychedelics might find that like, what the hell do you mean it's not visual? That's what psychedelics do. They just show you crazy stuff. But from my experience with a lot of these things, with mushrooms and even with my ayahuasca, though ayahuasca was generally very visual because it was DMT. But I do find it, a lot of it is about a feeling you get. And that's why it's so hard to explain. It's because it's just this weird feeling. Like, I didn't really see that I was in the singularity. I just felt this sense of like, oh my God, I'm at sort of some kind of end of time thing going on. It's weird. And I didn't, but it's not really, you don't always visualize everything. And that's hard for people to wrap their head around if they haven't had these experiences. But I want to ask you about sort of the difference between DMT and 5-MeO. Now, DMT, dimethyltryptamine, is what is in ayahuasca, and that is what is, it comes out of the chacruna leaf generally. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And the 5-MeO, does the 5-MeO-DMT only come from a toad? Is that right?
No. There's actually a variety of different grasses and plants and trees and seeds that produce 5-MeO. And it's also an ingredient in ayahuasca. It's far less common, but there are varieties of ayahuasca that are not made with DMT. They're made with 5-MeO.
So you can DMT. Does it react the same way where you need an inhibitor to go with it to make a brew like DMT?
Yeah, if you're going to be eating it or drinking it.
But you can do that you could basically make a 5-MeO ayahuasca brew if you wanted.
Yeah, and that's something that is out there within the ayahuasca world. And it's always interesting to talk to someone who's had a 5-MeO ayahuasca, especially if they're more used to the DMT ayahuasca, that they always come back saying, whoa, that was the most amazing ayahuasca experience I've ever had. It was so much stronger than any other ayahuasca experience. Well, that's because it's made with 5-MeO DMT. But it can also be snorted, and it can be smoked, or it can be vaporized. And in those instances, you don't need to use a monoamine oxidase inhibitor.
Okay. Yeah, at this retreat that I went to, I think they may have used a 5-MeO. Now, I didn't stay for that. They had they had two separate weeks. The first week was like an ayahuasca week, and then they did another week where they used Huachuma, which is like San Pedro, mescaline. And then during that week, they also did a snuff, which everyone snorted through like some old ancient bone thing. It sounded really cool. I wish I had stayed for that. And it might have been 5-MeO.
That probably was 5-MeO.
I wish I could remember what they called it, Vilca. I think they called it Vilca. I don't know if you know. But apparently what that does to people is basically, I think it is a non-dual experience where a lot of people report having the experience of dying. And that's kind of what they talk about is like, I just floated away and I was gone. Like I was out of my body and I was out of there. And it only lasts a very short time. But
That sounds like 5-MeO.
Okay. Because that's kind of, I think, that is very common with this non-dual experience. It's also this feeling of dying. Is that?
Yes. Yes. Because as the ego is dissolving, it thinks it's dying. It's like, oh my God, I'm dying. And that's presenting the ego with a choice. You can say, oh, I'm dying. Great. Yes. Let it happen. Or the ego says, no, I'm holding on. Or somewhere in between where someone says, okay, I'm dying and I want to die, but they have such deeply seated unconscious patterns onto that they're not able to dissolve past that point. So that there's a variety of reactions that people can have to that. But the most common description is the feeling of dying or merging with God or merging with the infinite or just becoming pure consciousness. And that can be terrifying from the perspective of the ego. And it's far more challenging than just writing out, say, a difficult mushroom trip or something like that, because it really feels like if I let go into this, I'm never, ever, 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 ever coming back. And the big joke is that 15 minutes later, they're back. But in the moment, the ego is convinced that, you know, this is it. This is the end of space and time and all reality. And here I go.
Right.
Never going to see anybody again. Never going to do anything again. It's just, I'm gone.
Yeah. And that's a big part of these psychedelics too, I think, is conquering fear. A lot of fear often comes up in all sorts of these experiences. But I know that you have to go here pretty quick, so we might as well wrap it up. This has been a really fun conversation, man. Thanks so much for talking to me today.
All right. Well, thanks for having me on. I've enjoyed it.
And maybe before you go, if you want to let people know where they should go to find out more about your work or get in touch with you or anything like that.
Yeah, my main webpage is www.martinball.net. And if you're interested in some cool fractal art, I'd invite you to check out fractalimagination.com. That's my art webpage. We have exploringpsychedelics.org, which is the conference that I run here in Ashland, Oregon. And we have entheologicalparadigm.net, which is kind of an encapsulation of my views of non-duality and what psychedelics are really good for.